Hey, what's going on, guys? This is Melons. Welcome to another episode of Melons Better Driving Videos. Today I wanted to discuss why I'm selling my Subaru and which car I'd like to get in place of my Subaru, and why I left CarThrottle, why I'm considering returning even despite having said that I'm not really the biggest fan of CarThrottle at this point in time, and I wanted to discuss essentially how the whole Hella Flush scene really is affecting the suspension geometries and so on of the cars that we're going to be building. You know, like, if you're trying to make your car look cool, how that really negatively affects the performance of your car and why it's like that. But people really need to consider what they're doing in terms of Hella Flush cars being completely useless on the track. I wanted to start off with explaining why I'm selling my Subaru, and a lot of it does come down to the cost of ownership of the Subaru being, you know, pretty hard on gas and brake pads and something, but also just the weight of it, just the... It sort of lets you down in terms of sporting potential. It doesn't. People will claim that it's so much of a sports car and it's got so much sporting potential and everything, but you. If you look at the weight and you compare it against other cars, then you'll see it really isn't as much of a sports car as people will say that it is. Not really a biggest fan of that. I would rather have so many things before it have that. Purely because of how heavy that Subaru is, I always continually find that the brakes aren't sufficient for the weight, and it's got wider tires that are more expensive in order to compensate for the weight, rather than just making the car more lightweight. But then again, because it's all-wheel drive, everybody already knows it's going to be heavy because it's all-wheel drive. You know, the second that you're going to talk about it, all-wheel drive car, it's going to be heavy because you're going to have twice as many drive shafts, twice as many axle shafts, half shafts, and differentials, and so on. Three times as many differentials, in fact, on average. That's something that the new Ford Focus RS really deals with a lot, is having the weight of those extra three or four differentials that car has that are all really going to affect the weight of the car. And then you compare that against a car like a 90s Civic or Hyundai Accent, anything that's noticeably lighter, like a Toyota MR2 or anything at all that weighs less than what the Subaru weighs, which is roughly 3,400 pounds in as driven spec. And then you've got cars that weigh like 2,000 pounds with fluids and driver on board, and you think, why? Why can't all cars be as light as that? Because it's so much better from a driving perspective. This car really needs to have its suspension reworked. I just, I can't help but feel like the suspension setup on this car is very twitchy, in a bad way, actually. I mean, it could be quick if you have the tires up to temperature and everything, but it's just very, very, very sideways until you get the tires up to temperature. And, that kind of lets this car down in terms of performance and lapping speed potential, but it's very fun to drive still. And that's something that the Subaru also really doesn't have, is this whole sort of playful... I energetic sort of feel to it. Subaru is just all about this grip and all about traction. It has very little sort of understeer or oversteer. It's just grip and grip and grip and grip and grip. But the way that it grips is sort of just body roll and brake fade, and you know that it's probably one of the easiest cars to crash just because it's so not sporty that when you try to drive it quickly, it sort of blunders in its own weight. And there are just many other cars that I would rather have given performance of the Subaru, where I sort of bought it under the assumption that it was a better car than it is in terms of the weight. When I realized how much fun I was having in lighter cars, I said, wow, I really need to reconsider my purchase of the Subaru. And then I considered the price difference between a car over the course of ownership between a Subaru and other cars like Civics and MR2s and stuff that are actually notably less expensive to own. And I thought, why am I still putting up with this? Why am I still doing this when it's not really even all that worth it? Like, when I'm driving this Subaru, there's hardly a benefit to the cost that you pay for it. When you have this WRX and you think, oh, this car is amazing, it's fantastic, it's awesome. It's an amazing car when you are sort of going to modify it and make it lighter and change the suspension and this and that, but it's a car that really costs a lot of money to do that stuff too. Oh man, just a very good point. Anytime that you don't want to actually put the money out there, anytime that you don't want to put the money out there to have a car that's modified with the big brake kit and the coilovers and so on, you're better off with the lighter car. And then even for the people who do want the big brake kits, that big brake kit that you're going to buy for your car will be more effective in a lighter weight car. So the question pretty much always begs be asked, why do that to a Subaru that weighs 3,500 pounds, give or take, when you could just do that to a car that doesn't weigh that much to begin with, and then all that money is going to be even better spent because it's a car that doesn't have the inherent problem of having all that excess weight when you start with. That starting point is so miserable that the finishing point can't be great. So, my next car, I don't know what it is. Please, feel free, if you have a suggestion, let me know what you think I should do with it. Like, tell me what sort of car you'd like me to see. The only thing I'm going to say is that it should have an aftermarket presence, because I would like coilovers and I would like a big brake kit, and I don't want to pay exorbitant amounts of money in order to have those things. Now, the next thing I want to talk about. I left CarThrottle. I used to be a moderator on CarThrottle, and I sort of said, look, I don't want to do it anymore because, well, there was a lot of political, well, not political in terms of, like, people voting for people or anything to do with democracy or politics in terms of the professional world of leading a country. There was nothing like that, but it was more politics in terms of just drama that was unnecessary and stuff that I don't even really want to talk about, but the user base just isn't the same as it used to be. You know, a lot of the people that I used to chat with and hang out with, they've all left the site as well. And so I felt completely justified in saying, hey, you know, let's take a step back and reconsider, should I stay on CarThrottle? And I really felt better off when I left it. But then after a while, I started to hear that people wanted me to come back. So I put it up to them and said, look, you guys want to see me come back, then I'll come back. And I got overwhelming support, so I will be continuing to post videos on the CarThrottle and so on, but I'm not going to be engaging in conversations and so on as frequently as before, simply because, well, I feel like the people that I would typically be in conversation with, they aren't even there. So it's kind of a waste of my time for me to try to chat with people that I don't even necessarily like. And they can come and find me if they want to chat with me. I'm still active in terms of if somebody tags me or mentions me in a comment or does whatever. I'm still around for that sort of thing, but in terms of me actively seeking a conversation on CarThrottle, I don't particularly predict it happening, simply because it's just not in my interest at this time, and it probably won't be for a while. Now, the last thing that I wanted to discuss. How bad Stance Nation and all that stance stuff is. This is one of the questions that a friend of mine named Dylan asked me to answer for him. It's a question that I really considered for a while and wanted to give the best possible answers, and so I racked my brain to remember what I could come up with to think, what sort of things are there that people should know about when they're lowering their cars beyond what I would call a reasonable drop, which is going to be maybe an inch, 2 inches, or maximum 3 inches. Okay. The first and foremost thing you should know about that is that the whole roll center of the car will change when you lower a car that much. So there are cars like the Subaru WRX that I have that have a roll center kit which can adjust the roll center of the car, given that you're going to have to adjust it because you're lowering the car, so the car's roll center becomes higher simply because of the way that the suspension geometry changes with the drop. You're going to have more camber, you're going to have, you know, less dynamic camber as a general rule of thumb, and more sort of static camber, and all this sorts of stuff that it's really hard to explain without a degree in engineering, but to understand it is difficult, but to understand the purpose of changing it is not as difficult. So when I'm saying this, I'm saying it as a recommendation that anybody who wants to lower their car really should consider the roll center kit, because a lot of times this roll center kit will change the car's behavior over bumps, especially. Like, you can have a really bad amount of bump steer, as it's called, if your car doesn't have the right roll center, because your car's roll center will change every time you hit a bump, and if the roll center is already off skew, however you want to say, if it's already upset and it's not where it should be, then it results in bump steer because the suspension can't really do the job that it was supposed to do given the camber and the ride height and the suspension travel. It all just works against the car in terms of absorbing the bumps and really trying to do what it's there for. Of course, that's a terrible thing because your suspension is there to do the purpose of you know, soaking up bumps and so on to keep your tire in contact with the road as much as possible. Well, that was a convenient demonstration of what happens when your tire isn't in contact with the road. Next lap, I'm gonna probably stay off that curve a little bit more. I feel like that's probably a really good idea for that. But you have to consider that your tire contact patch is changed by the camber, which inherently increases. On some cars more than others, yes, but generally all cars will have more negative camber when the ride height is lowered for one reason or another, and to try to assume that we know which, whatever reason that is, it's nonsense. You can't necessarily expect that you will know how your camber will change without getting a proper alignment done and everything, but to assume that it doesn't affect it, to not make the alignment and the recalibration of your ride height when you change your camber, and to not make your camber adjustments after changing the ride height, it just doesn't make any sense. You should always look into it and see, hey, if I changed my ride height, I wonder how that affected my camber, because they will change. Those two things are correlating with each other, you know? And so, a lot of people forget that. And then there's another thing that people sometimes do that's really bad when they're lowering their car beyond what I would call a reasonable drop. They fit these big wheels that don't fit, and then they fit these tiny, tiny, like, donut space saver type tires in order to fit the big wheel on with the drop. And they're lowering an already small contact patch because of the camber, to the point that they're riding on a penny-sized rubber patch, or not even riding on the wheels on the rubber tires at all. And you have to think, like, that will not be allowed on the track at all. That won't be allowed on the road at all. The only reason why you're doing that is to show people that you can just toss money out because you're grinding your wheel to hell, simply to make the point of, hey, I can afford to replace my wheels every 100 kilometers. Great, you're rich, thank you. Why don't you just buy a Rolls Royce if you want to flex your wallet that bloody much? You don't have to ruin a whole bunch of sets of wheels just to tell people that you're rich. Honestly, just go buy some female of some type who may like money a very obnoxious gold ring. Go do something with your money that doesn't involve ruining wheels. You know, just don't. And especially if you're going to haggle people over the price of them on Kijiji, just so that you can wear them down by riding your wheels on the road without any tire on them? Come on. Seriously? I've seen it happen, okay? And I really don't appreciate it. I can't help but think that the people who try to get away with that really are not very clever at all. So yeah. That's a little update in my life, and a little chat about problems with how the whole Stance Nation stuff really is ruining the track day scene by people going out and instead of modifying their car for a specific purpose in terms of making it fast or comfortable or better in any way, they're just changing it for the sake of changing it to brag about how much money they have. Well, why don't you just buy a cool car outright? Like, why don't you just spend that money for an Aston Martin or something instead of trying to tell people that you have a whole bunch of money by ruining stuff? I don't know. It's your choice at the end of the day, but I have my suggestions, and if you don't like them, then that's fine. But I don't really care. Yeah. The last thing I wanted to talk about, I'll just add this on at the end. Toe. I feel like everybody talks about camber when they're building track cars, building race cars, building drift cars, building whatever they're building, doing whatever they're doing. Everybody talks about camber, but nobody seems to talk about camber's big sister, toe. You know, when you have the wheels pointed in or out, as viewed from above. Nobody, I mean nobody seems to discuss camber and toe as if they're equals or if toe is more important. Everybody just says to leave it at zero. You can have a lot of fun with a car with just even the slightest bit of toe in, and it really doesn't even affect tire wear as much as you think it does. It's really worth contemplating whether or not you want to run with just a tenth or two of a degree of toe in, especially at the back, on a front-wheel drive car. Why don't you consider it? Why don't you look into the option of running with a little bit of the toe in, which is typically expressed as negative toe, but not always, because for some reason it's not always set the same way that negative toe and positive toe are not always the same, like as is with negative camber and positive camber. But if you set your car with toe in, where the front of the tires is viewed from above, the face towards the front of the car, they're angled in just the slightest bit that you can't visibly see with your eyes, but rather with laser when you're doing alignment, you can tell that you have the toe in, and it can have massive effect on the handling of your car, but I feel like everybody forgets to work with it. And a lot of people have toe adjustable links and so on in the suspension, like I have with my WRX, where it gives you the chance to adjust the steering on your car in another way, where you can adjust the way that the car behaves in heavy corners with another method, so you don't have to run with the same damper settings, same rebound settings, and so on. And then say, well, I want a little bit more oversteer, and change the damper settings again and make it even stiffer at the back, which might create an even more jarring ride when you're already concerned about how jarring the ride is. Well, have you looked elsewhere? Have you looked at tire widths and toe and camber and so on and really maximized the rest of your setup? If you're fighting the understeer and you want to have a little bit more oversteer, you want to have the back end be more playful. Have you exhausted the other options before you make the rear end so stiff and so not compliant that there's no compliance in your suspension at all? Because I feel like people, on the two wheels in that gravel zone, not good. I feel like a lot of people have forgotten how to set out with the goal of making the car handle better without just making the suspension rock hard to the point that it doesn't even compress anymore. And I dare say that the engineer of this car, because I haven't changed the tuning setup on this Clio at all, they haven't really given the suspension much compliance at all, I dare say. Because I'm running the same lines that I was with the Ford Focus RS and the Ford Falcon Australian V8 supercar. And I'm finding this car is a lot less stable over the bumps. And I'm pretty sure that has to do with people using dampers to do the sway bars job in this case. It kind of feels like the whole car really is unstable over bumps. And that's okay in its own right, but suspension compliance would be a good thing that I would try to tune into this car, and I would use the sway bar to fight the body roll, because there's next to no body roll, it feels like. But what you have, though, is a car that bounces and hops and skips and doesn't maintain good tire on the road contact in some places. And so, when I'm talking about making a car that's very fast and so on, a lot of times I'm going to tell people, look, you have your suspension too stiff. And other people are going to tell me, no, my suspension isn't too stiff because I know better than you because I saw the World Touring Car Championship cars and they've got very little suspension compliance. Well, yes, but some of the tracks that the WTCC drives on are ultra smooth. And then there are other tracks that just aren't smooth at all. And you look at tracks like Sebring, and you think, that's a bumpy track. That is probably the bumpiest track in the world. And then you look at some of the other tracks around, and you think of, let's say, Circuit Balbecau in France. That is one of the smoothest, most bump-free tracks in the world. It's smoothest tarmac that you will find pretty much anywhere. Or the newly repaved Watkins Glen. That one was just repaved. It's perfectly, perfectly smooth. And you compare, you know, at Watkins Glen or at Circuit Paul Ricard, I'm going to be riding around with no suspension at all because that's a perfect track for it. But then you rock up to Watkins Glen's previous version before they repaved it, or you rock up to Sebring or something, and you have to have a whole lot more suspension compliance in order to bounce over these bumps without losing tire contact patch. You know, because that's the nature of the beast, that your suspension will change from track to track to track to track, given the amount of bumps that each track has or does not have. But again, if your suspension is stiff on a track like Sebring because you're not utilizing your sway bars efficiently and stiffening up the sway bars on your car in order to compensate for body roll without introducing hopping or skipping or anything like that, then you're really not optimizing your car's performance. And I feel like there's a lot of people who really just haven't caught on to that yet. Whoa. Darn, I got it onto the grass. Yeah, I feel like because it's something like 4 or 5 a.m. when I'm recording this video, I'm perhaps not in my absolute prime for driving perfectly and perfectly well. Like, I've got generally the gist of this track in this car, but it's just this car is rather tricky, especially right now. I feel the car has a lot of understeer and a lot of oversteer all happening all at once. It's a very difficult car to predict in some cases, just because the grip level is low across all four corners a little bit. And I think, again, it comes down to the suspension stiffness in the case of this car. feels like the suspension really just isn't compliant enough for some of the bumps that you come across on even this track, which is relatively smooth as compared to some other tracks. There you have a perfect example of the car which really bounces a lot. I feel like I might pull into the pits and get myself some new tires, and then try to actually set a couple of impressive laps instead of what I'm doing right now. But to do that, I will pretty much just shut up and then allow the people to watch the rest of the video in relative peace and quiet. Anyways, before I sign completely off of the microphone, thank you for watching. Please comment, like, and share if you liked the video. Comment what you think about the video. If you disagree, tell me why you disagree. Tell me what you think. If you want to see a recommendation or a request for an upcoming video, let me know that in the comments. Or PM me on Facebook, or do as you will. And I will see you guys later. Oh. So tires are cold. There's no tire heaters. Anyways, as I was saying, I will see you hopefully next week. I'll be able to release a much better quality video than even this one. See you guys later. That's enough of an impression. Okay, that was a little ballsy. Still on cold tires. This game. Why don't they have heated tires? It's frustrating trying to get the tires up to temperature. Now I want to go for a hot lap. pretty sure I used a little bit too much curb on the entry to this corner up here. I think you'll see it. Yep. You can't really turn a car when it's up in the air. So, that's what that was. On which discipline you're in. Like, if you're in a Formula One car or something like that, typically you aren't going to use the same runoff room as the Formula or the touring cars. The Formula One cars and so on, they have way too much downforce, but the second that you lift your car off of the ground, then your downforce is gone and ineffective. But if you don't have all that much downforce, then you don't have that much downforce to lose, and if you don't have that much grip, then from time to time, bouncing the car off of the ground and losing that contact patch really doesn't have as much of an effect. Versus the Formula One car, if the tire comes off the ground in a Formula One car, that's a big loss of traction. In a little tiny Clio like this, that's just a small, tiny little loss of traction. It's not a big deal at all. This corner, yeah. Stay off the curbs. You can't really get it back stopped when you go onto the curb that much. Helmet view is kind of fascinating. My final lap time there was a 2:05 when I ran my actual fast lap, and after that 2:05 kinda said, you know, that's kinda quick. Probably not the greatest, but then again, I didn't practice very much, and so I'm not quite exactly sure about which curbs I can use to the maximum benefit. Like, I know those two I could, but the rest of them I was still deciding where I should use the curbs and where I shouldn't, so there's a lot more time to be had in my driving in this past video. Wasn't really set out with the goal of being the Bible of how to get around Imola. It's not the final word, it's not the holy word. It's just me mucking around, more or less, just enjoying my Saturday night. Well, Sunday morning, like I said, it's 5 a.m. here, but I feel like this is going to be pretty dramatic. Yeah, kind of looks like you're going to roll over from that view. Ooh. Anyways, thanks again for watching. Have a good week, and I will hopefully make another video for you guys next week. Thank you for watching. Have a good week.